Hi there, we're now live. So I want to say if you're in here now, you're going to have to press the go live button and say hello. Okay, so while we're waiting for people to file in, I just want to say say hello, type hello in the screen, and I'll say hello to you. And if you can confirm that you can hear me, we're doing a sound test. And if you can. Okay, so far the people that we've got in are Laura. Dr. J and Lester, if you could say hello, please. Hi, Lester. Thank you. Thank you for confirming that you can hear it. That's very helpful. Thank you, Laura. Hi, Robson. Mark J. Robson. Thank you. That's great. Yachtsman, thank you. Thank you very much. Hello. Welcome. I'm really very pleased that you can all see me and hear me. This is the first time I've done a webinar. So far everything's going okay. Hopefully the technology will hold up fine as we're going through it. At the moment I'm just waiting to make sure that everybody that wants to join us in the webinar gets a little bit of time to get themselves sorted out. In the meantime, if you could tell me what, I mean, does data cleaning take you a long time? Have a think about that and type it into the chat box. Does data cleaning take you a long time? How long does it typically take you? Here's another question that you can answer for me. What is your biggest Excel data cleaning problem? What do you typically have a problem with? Okay, so Lester's saying yes, he has a data cleaning problem, and the amount of time it takes him varies. How long, Lester? Give me an example of how long it can take you to do your data cleaning. Gene names messed up. Yeah, it depends on the data set and the outcome required. Absolutely. Yeah. But it's not usually minutes, is it? Hi, WK. Thank you. Thank you for confirming that your audio is fine. Welcome. So the questions that we're looking at the moment, just while we're saying hello, does data cleaning take you a long time? What is your biggest Excel data cleaning problem? And let me throw another one in there. If you were the one that was given the advice, what is the best advice you can give to a beginner? Somebody who's just starting out with data cleaning, what's the best advice you could give them? Okay, Lester, 30 to 60 minutes to prep a data set is a very, very short amount of time. Yes, if your data set is already prepped, then yes, you can do it in 30 to 60 minutes. But for me, it used to be days or even weeks with the data sets I was receiving. Okay, managing various date formats. Yes, that's a problem. And high quantities of text data. Yes, text data is a particularly difficult problem, and we're going to be talking about that today. There's lots and lots of problems that you'll get with text data. Version control. Right. Version control is something that we'll be talking about today as well. Part of what I'll be talking about is getting organized so that when you do your data cleaning, you have a number of different Excel worksheets so that you can work forwards cleaning your data, and then when you find an error in your data sometime later on, you can then work backwards to find where the problem occurred, when the problem occurred. So that's a very important thing. Thank you for that, WK. Use of cell styles in Excel. I'm taking it that's the best advice you can give to a beginner. Yes, you do different cell styles. You can color different cells to signify various things, or you can use the notes feature in Excel. They're all very useful things that you can do. Okay, so there's a few of you in here now. So I'm going to make a start, and we're going to go through a few different things here. Okay, so I want to introduce myself first and foremost. My name is Lee Baker. I'm the CEO of a company called Chi-Squared Innovations, and we work with data in many different forms. I've got lots and lots of experience with data. I've been working with it for almost 20 years. I worked on the Visible Human Project dataset, on the Human Genome Project data. I was responsible for analyzing a European soils database, which was very large. And my last job before I left academia to set up my own company was as a medical statistician. I did that for 7 years. So this webinar today, this is all about data cleaning in Excel for analysts and researchers. And what we'll be talking about today is how to organize your Excel spreadsheets. As I've mentioned, we will use a number of different spreadsheets to keep us organized in how we deal with our data. And I'll give you an introduction to that. We will learn about Excel's functions and formulae. I'm not going to go into any detail about those today, but introduce you to a few that that are very, very useful. And I want to. We're going to talk about how to quickly identify and clean incorrect data. So today you're in the right place if you have data and you want to learn to clean it quickly and effectively. If data cleaning takes weeks at a time, you're in the right place. I can help you with that. And you're also in the right place if you're always under pressure to analyze your data. On the other hand, what we're not going to talk about today is merging spreadsheets or databases. This is a completely different issue. We're not going to talk about cleaning customer data like names, addresses, telephone numbers. Most of that is done by manual means or very specialized programs. Excel is not the best place to do this. So we're not going to talk about that today. And we're not going to talk about methods of data cleaning outside Excel. So if you were to clean your data in Python or in Minitab or SPSS, something like that, we're not going to talk about that. It's just about Excel today. Okay, welcome Javed. fetching data via SQL. Yes, that's a that is a bit of an issue. That's a difficult one. Typically, you have to learn to program to do that. We're not going to talk about SQL today, but hopefully there'll be something in here that can help you along on your way. Okay, so here's what you'll learn in this webinar. I'll be talking about a very specific way to clean your data in Excel without learning how to program. When I say without learning how to program, I mean you won't have to learn how to program in C++ or Visual Basic or in Python or anything like that, but you will have to learn how to program in Excel. The simple formulae in Excel, to use those. And it's not very difficult, and I can help you with learning how to program those. So you won't need to learn how to program, but there is a very specific way of doing things. And there are basically five critical steps you need to take to get your data analysis ready. So let's see what we can do about minimizing distractions. So if we can turn phones off, close browser tabs, close the door, make sure your loved ones are all in bed and tucked up, and then we can have a good hour here and not be distracted. Feel free to take as many notes as you want, and also make sure that you stay right to the end of the presentation, because when we get to the end, I'll give you a link where you can download a PDF of this presentation to remind you of the five steps to getting your data analysis ready. Okay, so my story about data and how I learned to clean data. As I mentioned, I've worked with data for about 20 years on various projects, the Visible Human Project, the Human Genome Project, European Soils Database. And that was actually quite straightforward. All these data were perfectly clean and analysis ready. There was nothing for me to do except take the data, start analyzing it, and start making predictions with it. But then I left that and I became a medical statistician. I did this job for about 7 years, and my job was as a statistical consultant in one of the largest teaching hospitals in Europe. I worked with surgeons, nurses, pathologists, microbiologists, and there were well over 100 researchers that I worked with. And I worked on all of their data sets. There were over 300 of them. And the problem was that all these data sets needed cleaning and preparing before I could start analyzing them. And it was typically 2 weeks per data set. These were huge problems. The analysis was delayed for everybody. Progress was slow. My boss was unhappy, and I was unhappy. So what I needed to solve the problem was I basically needed to learn to use Excel more effectively. So I needed to learn the functions and the formulae in Excel. I needed a step-by-step process that was quick, simple, effective, and most of all, repeatable. If I can repeat it, I can fast-track my research on every data set that that comes into my office. So I set about learning how to use functions and formulae and try to build some kind of a process. And I had lots of problems along the way, lots of setbacks. And the biggest problem I had was identifying and cleaning spaces. The problem with Excel is that it ignores spaces. So it's really difficult to search for spaces. If you've got a space at the beginning of some text in a cell or at the end, you can't see it, but it's there. And you can't simply write a script to find it. It's really, really difficult. So the problems were such a huge problem. Finding the spaces were a huge problem. I tried many, many approaches to finding them and cleaning them, and most of them failed, but I eventually figured out the solution to it. And once I had a process that worked. The finding the spaces was the biggest problem, and once I sorted that, it all became quite straightforward. And then I had a process that was simple and effective, and it was mostly automated. There's very little manual data manipulation in there. Most of the data cleaning that you do is using the functions and the formulae to automate the data cleaning. So it became very simple to work with. And after that, the data sets were cleaned in a fraction of the time. The researchers were happy because I could get onto the analysis very quickly and give them some early results. My bosses were happy, and I was happy. In fact, it was so popular that all the researchers wanted it. So I taught it to them, hundreds of them, and they used it on their hundreds of data sets. And as a result of that, I then got lots of feedback from all these researchers. Every time they learned something new, they encountered a new situation, they'd come back to me and say, "Yeah, I've just learned something new. If you do it in this way, it's even faster than it was before." So I learned loads of new things as the researchers were going out there and working on their data sets. And the best thing was that they would bring their data sets to me perfectly clean, and I didn't need to clean them anymore. But I've now perfected this method. It took me several years to do it. I've been working with hundreds of researchers and hundreds of data sets that we've tested it on, and we've perfected it. And the method became so successful that I actually left my job. I started my own company, and I created a fully automated data cleaning program. And that's available on our website. It's called Data Cleaner, and it's completely automated in data cleaning processes. Now, I'm not here to talk about Data Cleaner today. You can check it out anytime you like. But today, I want to teach you the same process that I've perfected. So, we're going to talk about the data cleaning process now. I'm going to switch over to the slides. Just bear with me. I'm not used to this technology yet. So let's try this. Should go to that. Hopefully you should all see the slides and me in the top right hand corner. Can you tell me that's correct? Can you see the slide now? Okay, yes, thank you, Laura. Thank you. You can see the slides. Okay, so in the five steps to cleaning data set, the first step is plan, plan, plan. Second step is data collection. Third step is data cleaning. Then, thank you, Javed. Thank you, Dr. J. Fourth step is data classification. And the fifth step, data integrity. Thank you, Yachtsman. Right, so step one, plan, plan, plan. This is the one step that most people don't do very much when they first start the project. They go ahead and they collect their data, and then they start doing things with it. And usually after about 6, 12, 18 months, they later bring me their data set and their analyses, and they say to me, "Right, I just need this p-value to go into my project. So can you get me my p-value out of this data set?" And then I look at their data and I spend some time figuring things out and say, "Your data is not fit for purpose. You can't answer the questions, your questions with this, with this data." And the problem is that they didn't plan it properly in the beginning. It's heartbreaking for the researcher and for me when I tell them, "I'm sorry, but you have to go right back to the beginning. I know you've worked for 3 years on this, but it's just not going to work. Go back to the beginning." And it's all because they didn't plan. So when you're planning a project, you're planning collecting data and analyzing data, you need to think about every step of the project. Think about the beginning, the middle, and the end. When you're thinking about the beginning, there are a number of steps that you need to think about. So break each of these steps down. Write it down if you need to, but break it down into lots of little manageable steps, and do the same with the middle and with the end. If a step looks too big, break it down into sub-steps, and keep doing that, and plan every single step for the entire project all the way through from the beginning to the end. It is, I cannot stress how important it is to do your planning. Think about the type of data you'll collect. Will your data be fit for purpose? Will your data be capable of answering your questions? If you've planned things, every step along the way, you can follow mentally how you're going to collect your data, how you're going to clean your data, how you're going to analyze the data, and which statistics you're going to use on it, and the final outcome. And you can visualize all of that if you've planned properly. What statistics will you use on your data? What statistics package will you use? Now, this is really important. If you collect data in text format, so you've got a variable that requires you your text data to be small, medium, or large. These are categories. And then your statistics package won't accept text data. It needs it in integers, not small, medium, or large, but 1, 2, or 3. You've just introduced an extra step of work that you need to do on your data set. But if you knew in advance which statistics package you'll use, what you need to do to this to your data to get it ready for analysis, you would already know that it needs it in integer form. So you collect it in integers and you code your data on a code sheet. And I'll talk about that in a moment. So plan, plan, plan. If you're not sure about something, think about it some more. Plan some more. I cannot stress how important it is. Next step is data collection. Data collection is a really, really important part of data cleaning. The reason is because if you collect data and it's already mostly clean, you've just minimized the data cleaning that you have to do. You've just minimized the number of problems that you're going to encounter. So you need to collect your data in the best possible way that you can that minimizes problems for your data cleaning. So set standards for data collection. If you're going to collect a variable that requires categories of small, medium, large, well, there are many, many different ways in which you can type the word small. You can have it with a capital S or a small s. You can have it all capitals or all lowercase. There are many, many different ways in which you can have misspellings of it. So you try to minimize all these problems as much as you can by setting standards right from the beginning. If you've got multiple people that's going to collect data for you, make sure that every single one of them understands the standards that you require in your data collection. It's really, really important. Also, enter your data on a single Excel worksheet. If you put your data across multiple worksheets and you need to sort one of these worksheets by one of your variables, you've just got your data out of order with the other worksheets. You've just introduced a huge problem. If you can't restore that order back, you're going to have lots and lots of problems with your data. So the best way is to enter it on a single Excel worksheet. Make sure that each column is a single variable. Each row should be a single sample. A sample might be a patient or a test tube or a sale, if you're talking about sales of something. Row 1 should be the variable name, and column 1 should be a unique ID column. The unique ID column should start with, it should be integers, it should start with the number 1 and go down 2, 3, 4, and so on, all the way down to the bottom. Now, this is really important because if you at any time want to restore the order of the whole worksheet, you can just order by your unique ID column. So, here's what a good data set will look like, something like this. So, as we said before, it's a single worksheet. Each column is a single variable. Each row is a single sample. And the first row is the variable name. There are no empty columns. There are no empty rows. And if you have a good look at the data, it's pretty much clean already. There's very little that you'll need to do with this. So this data has been collected really carefully. And there'll be little data cleaning needed to do on it, but you still might do some pre-processing. The gender, for example, is male or female. You might need to have that in categories of one or two rather than male or female, depending on your statistics program. But it's a good start to have a data set that looks like this instead of clearly errors all over the place. Okay, so when it comes to data cleaning, it's all about being organized. It really is. You can learn about functions and formulae, and you can have a lot of experience, but the best thing I can tell you about data cleaning is be organized. And when I say be organized, I mean you have a separate Excel spreadsheet for a different thing that you're going to do. So when you put your data into Excel, you put it onto a single spreadsheet, and you call that spreadsheet raw data. Once all your data is entered, you make a copy of that, and you call that spreadsheet cleaning in progress, or something like that. Then you can start to do your cleaning. Once that's done, you want to make a copy of that, and you call it cleaned data. Once you've done that, you might need to do some pre-processing to get the data analysis ready. So you'll make a copy of that data set, of that spreadsheet, and call that data for analysis, and then do some more work on it. And the reason why we do this in steps is so that you can work backwards whenever you find an error in a spreadsheet. For example, a patient might be 300 years old. This happens because what you put into the spreadsheet is two dates, the date of birth and the date that this patient was admitted to hospital, for example. And the difference between those two dates will tell you the patient's age at admission to the hospital. And if you've got a patient who is over 300 years old, you know that one of these dates is incorrect. Once you've found that, you then go backwards through your spreadsheets until you've found the piece of data that is incorrect. And then you can correct it through all of your spreadsheets. It's just about being organized. It's all about being organized. You need a sheet for notes. So take lots and lots and lots of notes. Make a note of everything that you do. And you need another sheet for codes. So for example, if you've saved your size column, small, medium, and large categories, as text, small, medium, large, and you want to code them in your data for analysis sheet as 1, 2, or 3, you need to make a note of that in your codes sheet so that you don't have to remember it. Quite often people will do things in a data set and then later on that data set will pass to somebody else. And they look at the data set and say, I don't understand this at all. I don't know what they've done. And then the data set is of no use whatsoever. It has to be thrown away. So take notes. Put your codes in. Be clear about everything that you've done. And your data set will have a purpose long beyond you've even left the institution. So the second... Excuse me. The second part of data cleaning is learning Excel functions and formulae. It's not necessarily a difficult thing to do, but for those that are not used to programming, it could be a little bit awkward learning how to program these formulae. But once you get into the swing of things, it really isn't difficult. And there's a certain order in which you should apply these functions and formulae to get your data cleaned. I've given an example here on the screen of a particularly poor data set. In columns A, B, and C, you've got your data, which might have been extracted from a web page. It's got lots of icons in it, non-printing characters. It's a mess. And I've applied a formula, a simple formula, in columns E and F to clean this data without any manual intervention. So I've used the clean, the trim, and the proper formulae all in one to clean the data. And you can see that in the F column under prog, it's all the data is now clean. There are no spaces before or at the end or in between the words. All the non-printing characters have gone, and all the text is capitalized on the first letter of each word, but lowercase for the rest of it. And on the age column, the proper formula doesn't affect numbers. So that's just come out nice and clean. So you can see here how you can start off with some basically really, really horrible data and clean it by carefully using formulae that's already built into Excel. You don't need to do anything with them, and it cleans your data really, really effectively and very, very quickly. You can just drop your equation in and drag it down to the bottom of your data, and most of the problems just disappear. It won't do everything. It won't do absolutely everything. There will still be errors. For example, if the word positive has been misspelled, it won't clean that. You'll have to do that in a different step. But at least you've got rid of a lot of problems that you've had in this data set. Okay, let's move on. So the next step, step four, is coding your data. So as I mentioned before, if you have categories such as small, medium and large, but your statistics program needs it in integers 1, 2, 3, you need to learn how to code your data. Okay, you could go and manually code it. I've given an example here on the screen of something called grade 1, grade 2 or grade 3. You could go down the column and just type it in and transcribe it. So grade 1 would be 1, you type in 1. Grade 2 would be 2, you just type in 2, and so on. For every single one of your 30,000 entries. I don't think I'd fancy that. So the best way to do it is to learn how to use the formulae to do it. In this particular case, in columns F and G, I've created a lookup table. So grade 1 would be coded as 1, grade 2 as 2, grade 3 would be coded as 3. And then I've used VLOOKUP to look up what is in column 2 in the table in F and G to return the value that it finds. So I find that I can use the formula VLOOKUP to automatically transform data from one form to another. So one example would be that I might want to convert continuous data to categories. So if I've got age in my data set, I might want to convert the number 52.32 to 50s. I could do that by using transformations. And converting text categories to numerical, as I mentioned before, you can convert size, as in small, medium or large categories, to 1, 2 and 3, as I mentioned earlier, and in the example here with grade. It's an unusual way of using the formula VLOOKUP. I've never seen it used like this before, but it's something that I've used to great effect in the past. It's a very useful thing to learn to do. Okay, another thing that you'll need in coding your data is learning how to create composite variables. Now, some data is collected and some is calculated. So in the example here, weight is something that's collected. Height is also something that's collected. But body mass index is a calculation of weight and height. So you don't collect body mass index, you calculate it. So that this is how to create a composite variable. You get your two variables and you have a mathematical formula to be able to combine them. And this is absolutely typical problem that you have with any data set, because you have variables such as this that need to be calculated. You need to learn how to do this. Also, when you're coding your data, you need to learn how to round your data. And Excel's got formulae for this, so you can either round your data to however many decimal points you need, or you can round it up, or you can round it down. There are other formulae as well, such as ceiling, but I'm not going to touch on those at the moment. And finally, data integrity. Real life has rules, and your data has to have rules as well. They've got to follow those rules. So you need to learn how to use descriptive statistics to identify the incorrect data. You remember I said before about somebody that might be 300 years old? Well, clearly they're not, but there was a problem with the data. There was a problem with either of the dates that were used to calculate their age. Now, you put those dates in, and Excel says, yeah, there's no problem with these dates. There's no error here. And when it calculates the age, Excel will say again, oh, there's no problem here. This is a perfectly legitimate number. So Excel won't tell you that there's an error with your data. But clearly, it's not correct. Somebody is not 300 years old. So we use descriptive statistics on our data to try to tell us at a glance where the problems might be in our data set. And Excel has got lots of formulae for this. For these, you use count, you use min and max to find the limits of the data. You can use average, countif, count blank. These are all really good formulae to use. So let's have a look at this example. We've only got two variables here, age and height. We don't have a lot of data in it there. As you can see under the count, there are only 26 or 27 entries, but it could be 30,000 entries with a large data set. And you really don't want to be trawling through 30,000 entries to try to find where a problem might be. So you have to use formulae to try and find out the issues. So you work out the minimum value in each of these numerical columns. We can see here that the minimum age is negative and the minimum height is negative. Well, that can't be. You can't have a negative age and you can't have a negative height. So there are clearly issues in the data set. But you can see that at a glance. I've calculated the mean value using the average, and the maximum value, the maximum age, is 194 years. That's probably not right. And the maximum height is 21 meters. Yeah, that's probably not right either. So you can see that there are lots of issues in this data set. But your descriptive statistics are telling you that very, very quickly, very easily, without trawling through the data to try to identify things by eye. You can see here, using the COUNTIF formula, I've identified that there are some negative values in this. So I don't need to look for the negative values. It tells me how many negatives there are in the data set. It tells me how many zeros there are there and how many blank spaces there are. So there's quite a lot of information in there, and I can see at a glance what problems I've got with my data set. Another thing with data integrity is learning how to identify outliers. We already know that if somebody is 300 years old, that it's not correct. But what if somebody is 110 years old? That might be perfectly normal data. It might be correct. But do you want to analyze that patient's data in amongst all your data for the people that are 30 and 40 years old? It may well be an outlier, and you might want to exclude that from your data set. Or you might not, but if you can identify your outliers, see what they are, and see how they fit with the rest of your data, it makes it much, much easier for you to decide what you're going to do with your outliers, whether you're going to include them or exclude them from your analysis. So for this, you can use Excel formulae quartile or percentile. And as we can see with this example that I've put here, I've used the column age, and in column D, I've written a little formula there to tell me whether any of these data points are outliers. So when we look down, we can see that row 5, age 164 years, that's true. So that is an outlier. is probably actually an incorrect age. We might need to edit that. But a little bit further down, you've got zero, which somebody's not age zero, and somebody has a negative age. Well, that's not true either. So using these outlier formulae, we can find out whether somebody has got an incorrect measure, or whether the measure is actually just an outlier, and then we can make our decisions as to what we do with it. Okay, so we've talked about the different steps that we need to go through to clean your data set. I hope that in this very short webinar that I've given you some ideas about how to get organized and which formulae that you need to learn to use to be able to get the best out of your data and to clean it nicely. Now, I think we should talk about the Data Science University. In my emails to you, I mentioned that we, as of today, we are launching the Data Science University because there are problems with data in all its forms. And the problems with data cleaning, it's a really big issue because data cleaning is really messy and data analysis is very difficult. Statistics packages are complicated and the programming for data analysis needs special skills. Machine learning is also something that's very difficult to learn, and all these things are taught very poorly. So today we're launching the Data Science University. It's now live. And in this we teach online video courses dedicated to teaching data science to beginners. And the first course is open now. It's all about data cleaning in Excel for analysts and researchers. So I'm going to introduce that. So in this course, there are five modules. The first module is about data collection. So I'll be in that. I'll be talking about how to collect your data and how to do it effectively and efficiently to minimize your data cleaning. But I'm also going to go through every data cleaning step that you'll need to clean this kind of data. I'm also going to go through data codification and classification so that you can code all your data and get it ready for your statistical package and classifying your data. The next step is data integrity, as we mentioned, about getting your data fit for purpose and making sure that all the data are correct. And a final step is we're going to talk about working smarter rather than harder. And what you'll learn in this is I'm going to teach you my entire data cleaning method, every single step of it. I'm going to show you how to be organized with your data. I'm going to teach you all the functions and formulae that you will need in the precise order in which to clean it. If you do things in the wrong order, it's possible that you could introduce errors into your data. That's the worst case scenario. But the best case scenario is that actually you have to repeat certain steps. If you do step B followed by step A, you will often have to do step B again because you've done it in the wrong order. So there is an order in which to do things, and I will teach you this. I'll also show you about the types of data that you'll typically encounter and how to clean them. And I'll show you how to use descriptive statistics to understand your data, how to code these descriptive statistics and how to understand them. And I will also show you how to remove all trailing and leading steps, all trailing and leading spaces in your data set, all non-printed characters, and set the case of all your data in one step. And it takes less than 60 seconds. For me, when I used to get a data set, and it used to take me 2 weeks to clean the data set, most of that 2 weeks was spent trying to find spacers and non-printing characters and remove them, because if I didn't remove them, it would crash the data analyses I needed to do. Most of the 2 weeks were spent trying to find spacers. I've now discovered how to clean all of them out in one step in less than 60 seconds. And I cannot I cannot stress how important and how big a deal this is about getting rid of these spacers. So I'm going to teach you exactly how to do this, and I'm going to give you the formula and show you how to use the formula so that you can use it to get rid of all of your spacers and all of your non-printing characters from your dataset. I'll also give you the formula of how to identify all the outliers in your data with a single step, again, in less than 60 seconds. And that's a big deal as well, because outliers can make or break your analysis. If you've got lots of outliers in, it will skew the results that you're going to get. So you really need to make a strong decision as to whether you're going to include or exclude your outliers. So you need to find them first. And I'm going to show you the formula which will show you how to find all the outliers in less than 60 seconds. So what's included in this Excel course is every lesson there will be a video. You will get lecture notes in PDF format. You'll get all the Excel code you will need. You will get Excel workbooks with real examples, and you'll get practical examples using the code. I'll also give you a free 12-month license to our data cleaning program, Data Cleaner, which I mentioned before. It will clean your data set in a matter of seconds. It's completely automated. It's everything that I've learned over the last decade about automating data, and I've programmed it into one program so that you can clean everything in seconds, completely automated. I will give you a free 12-month license to Data Cleaner, and I will give you 300 Data Cleaner credits as well. I will also give you a practical data cleaning kit, which is an ebook. You get a cheat sheet to print out and stick on your wall, and you'll get an Excel workbook to help you get a great start. You will also get a certificate of course completion, which you can put onto your LinkedIn profile, and that can prove to your boss that you're good with handling data and can make a big difference when it comes to your next push for promotion. So, the benefits of doing a course like this are that you can learn to fast track your data analyses. Rather than taking weeks to clean your data, you can do it in a matter of a few hours, half a day, if you do it in Excel. If you do it in Data Cleaner, well, you can get it done in a matter of seconds or as long as minutes. And once you've fast-tracked your data analysis, you make your colleagues happy, you make your boss happy, and you make yourself happy, because there's just nothing worse than spending weeks of your life cleaning data, particularly when it's somebody else's data. Another benefit is that you enhance your reputation. When you do that, you get a much better chance of getting a promotion. And when you get a promotion, you get paid more money. So ultimately, this course is an investment in your career. And I'll also guarantee that if you're not completely satisfied, come and tell me why you're not happy. Tell me what you think is missing from this course. And if I can't fix the problem, I'll make you happy within 30 days. I'll give you all your money back in full, and you'll still keep access to the whole course. So, what does all this mean? Let's break it down by price. If you were to get your data set and take it to a data consultant and ask them to clean your data set, they will typically charge you about $500 a day. And if it takes 2 weeks to clean your data set, that'll cost you $5,000. But this course will only cost you $197, and you'll get your data cleaned much quicker. But I don't want you to think about that $5,000, because you wouldn't spend $5,000 to clean your data set. But what I do want you to think about is, for all the things that you're going to learn on this course and all the things that you're going to get as bonuses, ask yourself if it's worth $197. That's the important number, 197, not the 5,000. So remember, I'm also going to give you a 12-month license and 300 data cleaner credits. And that's currently worth £1,800. That's about $2,200. And I'm going to give it you for free. And you'll get your data cleaned in minutes or even seconds. So remember this course, when you break it all down, when you cost everything out, this course would be worth $7,200. But you get it for $197. So that's $7,000 less than what it's worth. Again, don't think about that $7,000, because you wouldn't pay $7,000 to clean your data set. I wouldn't pay it, and I wouldn't expect you to pay it either. That's not the important number. Ask yourself if $197 is the price worth paying to get everything from this course, to learn all the things that you get, and to get all the free bonuses that I'm throwing in. Okay, so there are limited places on the course, and registration will close soon. So at the bottom of the screen, just right below here, there's the buttons that you can use to purchase the course. You can either purchase it with Stripe or with PayPal, but it's open right now. The course is open, it's ready, and you get it at this special early bird price of $197. But this price will expire this Friday, the 17th of February, at 6 p.m. GMT, Greenwich Mean Time. 6 p.m. Greenwich Mean Time is when this offer will expire. So you've got a few days. Don't run away and do it now. But after this, early bird price, the price will be going up to $297. So now is actually a very good time to buy it. The course will commence on Monday the 27th of February. There will be 5 modules in the course, as I mentioned, and there will be 1 module per week. And you will get permanent access to all the course materials. Even after the course has closed and we're no longer selling it, you will still get access. You will keep all the resources permanently. They're yours to keep. So, very quickly, the benefits of this course are that you can fast track your data analyses and make your boss happy. And when your boss is happy, you enhance your reputation. You can get a promotion, get paid more money, so the course is an investment in your career. Remember, the course is worth $7,200, but you get it for $197. Is it worth it? That's your decision to make. $197 is all you'll pay for this course. So, thank you very much if you've bought this course. If you haven't, you've still got time right below here. Thank you very much, and thank you very much for coming here. And I want to ask now if there are any questions. So fire away. Ask your questions in the chat screen, and I'll see what I can do about answering them. In the meantime, as you're thinking about asking your questions, there is, as I promised right at the beginning, you can get the handouts for this webinar. And the address is on the screen, but I'm going to put in here in the chat box there is now the if you click on it, that will take you straight to the a page where you can get your handouts, the webinar handouts, and there's no sign up required. Yeah, Yachtsman, there's the PDF link right above. If you click that, that should take you straight through, and there's no sign up. That you can just, you go there and click the button, and you'll get the PDF. Right, and finally, as we're just waiting for any of you that still want to ask some questions, Quickly, a reminder of the early bird deadline. The early bird offer is $197 for this course. This offer will expire at 6 p.m. Greenwich Mean Time. That's 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time if you're in the US, on this Friday the 17th of February. There will be a replay of this webinar as long as the technology is held out and it's recorded correctly. But as long as it has, there will be a replay. I'll email you all when it's available to watch, and you can invite your friends to watch it. I'm just going to hold on for just a few more minutes in case anybody has got any questions they want to ask. Just type it into the chat box. So Yachtsman, do you manage to get through with your PDF link? Did you get through to get your PDF? So has anybody got any questions? I'm still here. So just tell me, did anybody manage to get through? Yachtsman, thank you. Yeah, Yachtsman confirmed that he did get the PDF. Okay, if anybody else wants to confirm whether they did or did not get the PDF. And any questions? Still no questions. Terry, thank you very much. Thank you for confirming that. Okay, Mark J. Robson, thank you very much. I'm just waiting for just another moment longer just to see if anybody has got any questions they want to ask. And if there are no more questions, then that is the end of the webinar. So thank you everybody for joining me. I hope you enjoyed it. More than that, I hope that you learned something new. I am planning to do lots more future webinars. I've only just got this equipment. I've thoroughly enjoyed it, and I'm going to do some more. So I hope you'll join me for future webinars. I'll do lots of different topics. And if you've got any particular topics that you'd like me to cover, email me. I'll see what I can do. So thank you very much, everybody. I really appreciate you joining me. Dr. J, thank you very much. You received the PDF. Thank you. And I'm going to close the webinar now. So thank you very much for joining me. And I'd love to see you again another time. Thank you.